So let me ask you one question. According to you, whether you are just studying ACCA, whether you're a business owner, or whether you're an investor, according to you, which is the most important line item in any financial statement? Mark Cuban from Shark Tank always says, sales cures all. What does he mean by that? He means that any company, if it has to be successful, the most important thing that has to be proven are its sales, is its revenue. Why? Because think about it like this. If revenue keeps going up, it doesn't matter how high your expenses are. If your revenue is higher, your company is going to become profitable. There are so many companies, you take the biggest companies in the world, which have the highest market cap, which have the most amount of brand value. It's because whether you take Coke, you take Walmart, you take Apple, you take Amazon, it's because all of these companies have incredible sales, right? In fact, there are companies like Amazon which made losses for years and years, but investors and the world kept on believing in this company purely because its revenue, its sales kept on going up. That is why sales is the most, in most financial statements, by the way, sales, the revenue figure, will be the biggest line item in all of its financial statements. Barring a few exceptions like the manufacturing companies, where sometimes the fixed assets could be higher. But majority of the companies will have their top line, that's revenue is basically called the top line. Top line will be the biggest one. Now, another reason why it's such an important aspect is because it's so important, revenue is the most susceptible to manipulation. Just think about it like this. If my company's revenue can be inflated incorrectly, if I show that my company's revenue is much higher, automatically my profits will increase. Because my profits increase, if my company's public, if it's in the share market, if it's in the stock market, people are going to feel more and more interested, more, my company's going to seem more attractive to them. And because of that, they will invest more in my company. When they invest more in my company, my demand goes up. So accordingly, my share price goes up and my value goes up. So see the logic. If I can increase sales, I increase profit. If I increase profit, my share price goes up. If my share price goes up, my value goes up. So it all starts with revenue. Right? There are so many executives in the corporate world whose year-end bonuses, whose actual payout is all linked to revenue. So that means that they know that, you know what, if I'm going to work here for 5 years, let's say per year I inflate the revenue just by 20%, by 30%, their bonuses will increase by 20-30%, for example. So what I'm trying to say is, revenue, not only is it important for the real fundamental understanding of the business from the business owner's perspective or the investor's perspective, but it's also a very manipulated line item. And because of this, the IFRS body, which is IASB, has come up, which is the International Accounting Standards Board, has come up with IFRS 15, which is called Revenue from Contracts of Customers. This IFRS 15 is one of the most important accounting standards, so that when accountants like you and me would ever help a company build up its financial statements and we write the revenue figure, we're writing the accurate revenue figure. See, revenue can be, let me make it very relatable to you and me. There are two types of revenues. One is very simple. Let's say I want to go and buy a bottle of water from a retail store. Okay, so I'll go down the street, I'll go to a retail store, he'll tell me, okay, I want a bottle for 20 rupees, I'll give him the 20 rupees, he'll give me the bottle, it's done. Now he, as the business owner, he will go and write 20 rupees in his financial statements. That's simple. But if I take a more complex situation, let's say you order from Amazon. When you order from Flipkart, when you order, let's say you're saying it's a cash on delivery transaction, right? Flipkart will, let's say you purchase some electronic item. Let's say you purchase a phone, simple, right? When they sell you, when they dispatch the phone, do they mark the sale in their books? How do you have any idea? When you get it and you pay them, will they mark it at that? Will they calculate the sales at that time? When do they record sales? Right? Sometimes it's more complex than just going and buying a bottle of water. Imagine it's a building, I'm a builder, I'm a construction person, I'm building a building. Buildings take years to make. But it's not fair for me as a construction owner or as a building owner that for 5 years when I'm constructing my building, right, I am constantly marking expenses, 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 non-stop with zero revenue. And then suddenly after 5 years when I get paid from, whether it's from people who are going to be staying in the residential property or it's from whoever, that time suddenly 5 years later I mark it. If that's the case of 5 years, I'm just making pure losses. So what a revenue has to, what this accounting standard IFRS 15 has to do is find a model, find a way that accurately predicts and gives the reader of the financial statement an accurate sense of what the revenue is. And this entire standard for F7 purposes will be on lines of how to record the correct amount of revenue. So now you guys know that Apple is supposed to be, I don't know if you guys know, first of all, Apple should be coming to the world's first $1 trillion company. By $1 trillion company, what do I mean? I mean that its market cap. Okay, by the way, for those who don't understand what market cap is, market capitalization is the market capitalization is equal to number of shares of Apple which are in the market multiplied by the Apple share price. So today they say, in fact, this was, I just heard about this yesterday. If Apple's share price goes up by $20, it'll be the first company in history to reach a $1 trillion market cap. It means it's the world's most valued company, right? And why is that happening? The most recent phones, I'm sure everyone knows, for Apple are 8, 8 Plus and iPhone X, 10, whatever you want to call it, right? Now, people were initially very skeptical about its sales, but it's killing it, okay? Apple, in the world of smartphones today, across the world, Apple is dominating in sales. What happens when you dominate in revenue, right? Apple's, not only is the sale, not only is the top line going up, but so are its profits. So is people like Warren Buffett are more and more interested in Apple because of its revenue going up. All across the world, people want to invest in Apple. They put their money in Apple. When more and more people are putting money, when I say putting money, I mean they buy shares of Apple. When people buy shares, the demand of Apple is going higher and higher. So is the share price. So that's how, like, remember, market cap is number of shares into share price. If share price keeps going up, the market cap keeps going up. That's the reason why directly Apple's revenue is the reason that Apple will reach a $1 trillion market cap, probably the first company in the history of the world. Also, there are predictions that along with Apple, there's Alphabet. Alphabet is Google's parent, as well as Amazon. These three companies will be either, there's a race, or if not a race, all these three companies should be soon reaching a $1 trillion mark, all because of sales. Right, so this entire chapter of IFRS 15 we'll be covering in the next couple of hours, and we'll be relating it to these kind of examples on and on, so that everything in F7 you can relate it to these Apple, Amazon examples. Remember them in the exam. So in the exam, if they ask you any question which you're a little confused about, try and relate this lecture, try and relate these examples in the exam. Right, don't just listen right and forget it, because the whole point of this is that you can keep it relatable. So basically, I'm using the BBB textbook. I'm assuming you guys are using the same one, right? What I'm going to do is, I'm going to go subtopic by subtopic. How much ever I feel is to be self-studied or read by yourselves and is not important it's to be read by yourself, and I don't need to explain you guys. I'm just going to ask you all to read it later, right? So if you see point number one, introduction 1.1, please guys read. It's just nicely giving an introduction of how important revenue is. There were so many scams in the past. Most of us would have heard of Enron. If you've not heard about Enron, Satyam in India a few years back was like the Enron of India. So Enron was one of the biggest scams in the world. Biggest scams. Thousands and thousands of people lost their life savings because Enron had indirectly, what they had done is that inflated the revenue. Remember in the beginning I told you, if you inflate your revenue, your share price eventually goes up. But if the revenue is inflated fake in without any substance, without actual revenue, then the share price will eventually reach a peak and crash. So imagine all the poor people who bought Enron when it was at its peak without knowing that Enron was scamming them. So they bought when the share price was very high, thinking it's still going to go higher. Okay. And at that time, the Enron scam was basically, it came to light. So Enron went bankrupt. What happened is, Imagine somebody bought Enron at the peak. They put in hundreds of thousands of dollars, or in rupees, you say, you know, tens of lakhs of rupees in Enron, their whole life saving, thinking that Enron will double, triple their money. It was at its peak. The scam came to light of revenue and Enron's share prices crashed. So somebody who had invested 10 lakh, for example, landed up with 50 rupees. And people lost so much because of scams related to revenue. That's what 1.1 is talking about. If you see point number 2, the subtopic 2, that is just giving a gist of what IFRS 15 is about. Again, what we already covered. 2.1 you can read. Now I'll come to definitions of 2.2 soon. But in just one major thing to understand, a lot of us, we sort of interchange the word revenue with income. Right? We say income is this much or revenue is this much, and we think it's the same thing. Well, you can use it interchangeably when you're talking day to day with people, but as a finance professional, you should know the difference. The difference between income and revenue is, revenue is when you talk about the company's core business activities, right? So there are companies which do, which the core of it is one thing, and they do 2-3 different things. All right. But the core, whenever money comes in from that, it's called revenue. Right. So I'll give you an example. So let's take Google. Right. Do you know how Google makes most of its? You know what Google is basically? Its core was what? Search engine. Right. Today, when you go on Google, if you search for anything, the top couple of spots are called ads. Right. So Google will have an idea of every website on the internet and it will start ranking them based on the popularity, the relevant content. So if you search for, what match is being played today or what happened in yesterday's match, it'll show the best sites which have the best content, which have the best views. It'll show those websites first, right? But above that, it can show websites where people are paying Google that saying that please put my website right on the top. That the money it gets for its ads is the core function of Google, right? They make billions of dollars every year only through these ads. But on the side, Google also invests in different things. It's also investing in tech, which is a little different. It's also investing in education. Now, any income, any inflow that they generate from these other sources, all of that is income. And only what it gets from these AdWords is revenue. Right, so just remember this particular distinction. In 2.2, they explain income and revenue. So I'm just reading income. So increase in economic benefits during accounting period in the form of inflows or enhancements of assets, meaning when it's still getting some sort of inflow from the education side of it, of Google, okay, or decrease of liabilities, the result in an increase in equity other than those related. Okay, you guys can read it at home. The point is that income which is not from its core activities, and just read revenue, it's simple, it's income arising in the course of entities' ordinary activities, right? So anyways, that's the distinction between revenue and income. Don't use it interchangeably. Even if you're using it interchangeably, you should, as an F7 student, now know the difference between income and revenue, right? That's 2.2. you can read the rest of the definitions later, we'll come to it. Now point number 3 is the most important reason that I feel F7 revenue is super easy because of this, right? What IFRS 15, you guys should know that before IFRS 15, which is the revenue model, a revenue standard, there was another standard prior to this. IFRS 15 came very recently. Before that, it was known as IAS 18, International Accounting Standard number 18. That was the revenue standard. That time what happened is they used to say that there were a lot of sort of gaps in the accounting standard, which eventually, in spite of them trying really hard to make it, you know, very accurate, people still managed to create frauds. They still managed to inflate revenue. They still had a lot of things which they did incorrectly, making the entire accounting purpose of it only sort of, you know, decreased. So they came out with a new standard, IFRS 15. IFRS 15 now says that whether it's a product or a service, when does the company record the sale? So let's take Amazon. Let's take the retail store where you went and bought the bottle of water. When does that guy record sales? Let's say that store owner, he's a small guy, you know, when should he record the sales? The actual answer, if you ever get confused, is the word is control. The minute he gives you the bottle of water and the control of that product is in the hands of the customer, he should recognize revenue. Making sense? So, because he hands it over, even if you go and buy something much simpler, you go shopping, you buy clothes, the minute you pay them the price of whatever you purchase, the minute you take it with you, the control is with you. That's when they can recognize revenue. That's the keyword. So if you ever get anybody ever, especially in interviews and all, asks you, the keyword to remember for revenue is control. Okay, so let's take into account point number 3, the 5-step model of IFRS 15. The logic here is that if you apply these 5 steps to any transaction, as long as these 5 steps get fulfilled, you can recognize revenue. Okay. Now remember, these 5 steps are applicable from F7's perspective. In the real world, all 5 steps might not apply to every transaction. But if you can, like, first step will apply, second step will apply, maybe third and fourth won't apply, fifth will apply. But what will happen is that somewhere down the line, once all these 5 are checked in your head with the transaction, you can recognize it as revenue. So IFRS 15 has made these 5-step model, this 5-step model, which makes it super easy from F7 perspective, right? Now, what is this 5-step model? See, guys, remember this 5-step model is very easy to keep in mind, because once you understand it, you can mug it up. But once you understand these 5 steps, you can apply it not only in the exam, but actually in real life, right? If you ever go for some interview and they're going to ask you on revenue, which most of the times they might, because revenue is the most one of the most important standards. If you can understand these 5 steps, you'll be able to apply it anywhere. Now, I'm going to use an example that BPP has given, so it's easier for you all to relate when you all are reading it at home as well, right? They've given the example of when you buy a laptop, you get a warranty with it. That's it. So let's make it like I'm going to the Apple store to buy the MacBook, and I am planning on buying the MacBook Air along with the warranty. In fact, we just bought it the other day. The idea is, should we take warranty or no? In our answer, it's yes. Okay. So we went there, and the 5-step process follows like this. Okay. Step number 1 is that we need to identify the contract, right? What does that mean? I went to the Apple store. I told them I want to buy the MacBook Pro, Air. That's it. That's like sort of the verbal contract. If they made me sign something, that would be a written contract. But there we've identified a contract. Remember, I am the customer. The Apple store is the company which is recording revenue. So right now, IFRS 15 applies to them. I'm just the customer, right? So I went there. I said, okay, I want the MacBook Air with warranty. By the way, that's the contract, right? I identify the contract. Second, identify separate performance obligations. What are performance obligations? I suggest for now, replace the word performance obligations with the word promise, right? So basically, identify separate promises that Apple is making to me. According to you, what are the promises? 1, they're going to give me the MacBook Air. 2, they're going to give me a warranty. And by the way, remember, I'm going to be paying them separately for both. Huh? So that's why they're 2 separate promises. If I said no for the warranty, then the Apple, for the Mac for me would be much cheaper. Slightly cheaper, right? Step number 3 is that we've got to determine the transaction price. In simple terms, it's how much am I paying Apple for this? Let's say that for this entire thing, for the Apple, I pay them 60,000 rupees, right? For the MacBook Air as well as the warranty, I paid them. The bill came to 60,000 rupees, right? Forget taxes and all. So step number 3 is that I've determined the transaction price, which is 60,000 rupees. Right. 3 steps are easy. Identify contract, identify separate promises made, figure out the price. Simple. It happens anywhere. You can relate these 3 examples to going anywhere. You go and buy that bottle of water which I was talking about. You tell him I want the bottle of water. Step number 1. He tells what is the promise that he's just giving you a bottle of water. His promise is that I'm going to give it to you. 3rd is the price. In that case, it was 20 rupees. Simple. It will apply to every transaction possible. That's why they made this model. Step number 4 is what we have to now do is, in step number 3, whatever was the transaction price, whatever was the price, we need to allocate part of it to different promises made in that one contract. 60,000 rupees mein, let's say that out of that, 5,000 rupees was for the warranty, 55,000 was for the MacBook Air, right? I paid them 60. For me, it doesn't matter as a customer. I don't care how I'm paying them. For them to recognize it in their books of accounts, they have to show the MacBook went for 55,000, the warranty went for 5,000. So now what did I do? I split the promises that they made to me to the transaction price. So 60,000, part of it is 55,000, which is the MacBook Air. Part of it is warranty. By the way, the warranty in this case is for 2 years. Make sense? What would it be for the bottle of water? Nothing. He's just giving me his promise is only one, the bottle of water. So in this case, what do I allocate the price was 20 rupees? I allocate the price to the bottle of water. There was no other promise in that transaction, but in this contract there is. Right? So I identify the contract. I want the MacBook Air with warranty. I identify the two promises, the MacBook Air and the warranty. The transaction price, step number 3 was 60,000 rupees. Step number 4, out of 60,000, how much is for the MacBook Air? How much is for the warranty? Right? And the last step is that Apple as the company recognizes revenue only when they satisfy this performance obligation, when they fulfill this promise. What does that mean? Apple gave me the MacBook Air yesterday. They fulfilled their promise of delivering the MacBook Air. So when I take that and they fulfilled, I took control. Remember the word control? When I take control of Apple, of the MacBook Air, they can recognize 55,000 then. So yesterday when I took the MacBook Air, they recorded 55,000 in their books of accounts because they fulfilled one promise. Now, make sense this much, right? Now let's come to the second promise, which is the warranty. Let's say that I bought it on 1st April 2018 and their year end is 31st March 2019. When would they fulfill the obligation of the warranty? It's for 2 years. So either at the end of 1 year, right? So, I mean, it is only at the end of one. There's no either. Sorry. So when do they fulfill the promise? At the end of the first year, they will fulfill half of the warranty promise because the warranty is for 2 years. Okay. So remember, I'm just showing you like 60,000 was the entire transaction price. 55,000 was the MacBook Pro Air. They fulfilled this promise, it's done. They recorded 55,000. The other 5,000 is over 2 years, which means in this year it's 2,500 and next year is 2,500. So let's talk about year one, which is 2018-19. When do they record this? They record this at the end of 2018-19, when the whole year has passed and they have fulfilled their promise of providing me warranty if I needed it. When the year ended, I must have gone to them, not gone to them, irrespective. That out of the 5,000, 2,500 can now be recorded. Because not in the middle of the year, because they have not fulfilled the promise. The year was not over. They had promised me the performance obligation. The promise was they will give me warranty for 2 years. So at the end of 1 year, when the warranty was complete, they could recognize revenue of 2,500. So what is happening? They've recorded half the revenue because they've fulfilled half of the promise. 2019-20, at the end of it, they will recognize the other 2,500 because now it's been 2 years, they've completely fulfilled their promise. They satisfied the performance obligation, right? So now, next year, that extra 2,500 of the warranty which I had paid them in that 60,000 will be recorded in the books of accounts. Is the whole thing making sense? So, and relating it to the bottle of water, there's nothing. His promise was giving me the bottle of water. I paid him 20 rupees. He satisfied it the minute he gave it to me. So he must have recorded 20 rupees on the spot. Apple will, that means, record 55,000 plus 2,500, which is 57,500 at the end of the first year, 2018-19. And even though I paid them 60,000, see, I paid them 60,000 today in 2018-19, but they will record only 57,500. And the balance 2,500, even though I paid them in 18-19, they will record it in 19-20. Because that's the time we fulfill their promise. So this is how the five-step model works, right? Identify contract, identify separate promises or performance obligations, determine the transaction price, in this case 60,000 rupees, allocate the different promises, in this case the MacBook Pro Air with the warranty, to the 60,000, in our case 55,000, plus 5,000, half of this year, half of next year. And you finally recognize Apple will recognize all these revenues when they have fulfilled their promise to me, when they satisfy the performance obligation to me, which in this year was 57,500 and next year will be 2,500. So now that we have an idea of the five-step model, the most important thing for ACCA, and this is not for F7 guys, this is personally I'm telling you all, every single ACCA student or member who's been giving and passing exams will tell you all, the most important thing to do after understanding a concept is going and practicing the questions of the previous papers from the exam kit, right? It's a rule which cannot be broken. You cannot read the question. I'm going to do right now. If you guys can open the PNR of your BBB book to page 26, and we are going to be doing the MCQ for question number 9090. Right? Please understand, I'm just repeating once again for your benefit. Do not read. When I'm solving it, open up a book and solve. Even if you're writing mechanically, I don't care. Writing the entire revision kit is your ticket to passing ACCA. Personally, I can vouch for that. Right, our entire team, everyone who's passed ACCA passes only like this. Right, please do not sit and read. I'm repeating myself again and again, and make sure that everything that you think you've understood, there will be a question in the exam kit. Go and read it, go and solve it, and that is only the only way you'll solidify your concepts. Also, good questions that you feel now, which you didn't get specially, or which was complex and you still got and you felt really good about it, mark them. So that you know that towards the end, when the exams are approaching, you can focus on these few questions. Also, one trick, one more thing. Let's say that right now we'll do one question, but there are 10 questions of revenue. The other 9, try and solve them by yourself. But if you cannot, when you go back to the answer and you're reading it, you know, you tried solving it, you didn't get it, you didn't know how to start it, you didn't know how to, you got stuck somewhere, you got it wrong. Go back, do not read it. Instantly start copying it down. As long as you're penning it down, I am telling you, you will be imbibing more and more of the answer, and that's the only way that you will retain the answer much better than if you read it and you know you were like, oh yeah, I understood now. So next time I'll not make this mistake. That will not happen. Repeat, just keep, when you're doing the exam kit, keep a book open where you're constantly writing. All right, this is the, you know, it's forced upon on almost every student at Zell. I'm hoping that you guys will do it as well. So as usual, the golden rule of reading questions is we start with the requirement. So what's the requirement saying? In accordance with IFRS 15, what amount will be recognized as revenue on each package in the first year? Very important. What are they asking? They're asking basically from the company's point of view, how much revenue to recognize in year one. So we have to understand, okay, we've got to apply the five-step model for 1 year, which is the first year, which means obviously the question will have more than a couple of years. Let's start reading the question further. I mean, from the top. Derrindo sells a package which gives customers a free laptop when they sign a 2-year contract for the provision of broadband services. Okay. What does this mean? Wait, just take a pause, guys. What does this mean? This means that the company is giving the customer two things. Right, one is the laptop, which is for free apparently. Second is the broadband service, and they're packaging this, right? So the customer will pay one amount and the company will give the customer two things. Remember how this already falls under the five-step model. The company is promising me two things. Okay, continue reading the question. The laptop has a standalone price of $200 and the broadband contract is for $30 per month. Okay, so the laptop is $200, which I'm getting for free. So I, as a customer, I'm not paying $200, but they're giving it to me for some reason, right? Plus they're saying the contract for the broadband service is $30 per month, which I have to pay. So what is it saying? That I, as a customer, I'm getting a $200 laptop for free. And in return, I'm paying what I would have any which ways paid for the broadband contract, which is $30 per month for 2 years. And I have to figure out the revenue for year one. From the company's perspective, right? So the questions which should start coming to your mind right now are, okay, laptop is for free. Will they recognize any revenue on it? The broadband service is for 2 years. How do I allocate it to 1 year? Also, the customer is paying one amount, but there are two promises, right? So these are the things which should go in your head. This is how you'll be able to pick out questions in the exam in F7. And this is the way your mind has to start working from now, and not wait for the answers to come to you. So we'll just start with the answer now, okay? So the question basically told us that the laptop has been given for free. But and in return with that, we have to compulsorily buy the broadband connection for 2 years. with $30 per month. So what does that mean? That as a customer, I don't care if I'm paying $30 a month, I'm getting the laptop for free. So laptop is zero payment from my end, and I have to pay a total of $30 for 2 years. So $30 into 12 for 1 year, which is $360, into 2, which is $720. So in $720, I am getting not only the broadband, which is the actual amount in the market, by the way, that if I went and bought broadband separately, I would have to anyways pay $30 per month. But in this deal, I'm getting a laptop for free. So as a customer, I'm happy. Now, from the company's perspective, think about how the company has to recognize revenue. They can't recognize $720 just under broadband revenue and show laptop revenue as zero. Because what is happening is the company is buying the laptop also. They're paying for the laptop. It's in their inventory. It's in their purchases. And suddenly, because they're giving it us to us for free, they can't show it at zero. Because what it means is that they're making zero return on the laptop. What they have to instead do is they have to split the revenue that I pay them, which is, remember, $720. What I pay them, they have to split that between broadband connection as well as the laptop. Right? So I'll explain how this fits in the five-step model as well. I wanted to purchase the laptop plus broadband connection, which they are telling me laptop is for free, broadband connection is $30 for 24 months. That's the identification of the contract. Second part is the two separate promises. What are they? Laptop I'm getting, plus I'm getting the broadband connection. Third, determine the price. Price is what? I don't care about whether they're giving, how they'll be recording it. They are giving me, I have to totally pay them a total of $30 for 24 months. That is $720. The transaction price is $720. Right? The fourth point is allocate. Remember? So I'll show you how to allocate. That's the major part of this sum. Right? And the fifth one is you recognize the revenue as and when the performance obligations are being fulfilled. Right? So basically, this entire sum is focusing on step 4 and 5 of the five-step model. So I'm going to show you all my way of understanding it. Okay? Now, they've said that the laptop actually would have cost $200 if I would have gone and bought it from the market. Right? So what it should have been costing me as a customer is the laptop would be $200 and the broadband connection would be $720. And $720, by the way, guys, is $30 into 12 months into 2 years. Okay. So the total amount which I had to pay, which I should have paid, was $920. Right? Now, what is the company offering me as a customer? That rather, you don't have to worry about this. You only have to pay $720. So I'm happy. I'm going to go to them. What they need to figure out is what revenue to recognize. Actually, they're going to recognize 720. How much of this should be allocated between the two promises? Remember step number 4, allocate the transaction price to the two promises, which are the laptop and the broadband. Right? How do you do it basically is, for F7 purposes, or you make sure that this is, it's called prorata, it's called proportionate. This has to be in the same proportion as this. And it's very simple to do that. Okay, you guys know how to cross multiply, right? So think about it. If the total should have been this, but it's actually this, how much would this be? Right? So how does it work? I'm guessing for most of you all who should know, it's basically if 920 is the total, but I'm paying 720. When it was 920, I'm paying 200 for the laptop. How much should I pay for when it's 720? Right? For the guys who don't know this calculation, it's called cross multiplication. Right? I'll do x is equal to 720 into 200 divided by 920. Right? And that total figure comes to 158. Right? How did I'm repeating, okay? I'm showing the formula again. If I should have paid 920 when the laptop was worth 200, how much should I pay for the laptop when I'm actually paying 720? So this X amount I have to find, which I do through cross multiplication, which gives me 158. Same thing I apply for this, right? And like, come on, if you guys should know that by default, the difference I would have gotten. But even if I cross multiply, I'll get the same thing. What is the cross multiplication for this? If I should have paid 920, and for that I would have paid 720 for my broadband service. Now when I'm paying a total of 720, how much should I pay for the broadband service? So 720 into 720 divided by 920. So it's just cross multiplication, right? That gives me these figures. This is the actual revenue that, this is step number four, guys. Allocating the transaction price, this is the transaction price. Allocating the transaction price to the two promises, laptop and broadband. Got it? This is how we fulfill step number four. Last step, which is step number five, is how does the company make sure that these two things are recognized, these two line items are recognized in revenue? Can they recognize a direct 720? No, because part of it, the broadband service is spread over 2 years. So you can't recognize the 2 years today, even though you're getting the money today, because the performance obligation, the promise of 2 years cannot be satisfied in 1 year. Got it? But the laptop is satisfied in 1 year. So I'm just going to sort of summarize, right? In year one, when the company has to recognize revenue, can they recognize the laptop revenue? Have they been able to fulfill the promise of delivering the laptop to me in this year, in year one? Yeah, because they gave it to me when I went and took this, so this entire package of theirs. Right, the question is saying that I went and bought this package, or will they give me a free laptop? They're giving me the laptop today. They did fulfill their promise. I took control over the laptop. The revenue can be recognized. The performance obligation, the promise has been satisfied. Right, so what laptop actually in the market is worth 200. But in this case, I'm going to recognize 158 because of step number four, which is I'm allocating the price to the promise that this company's made me. Right? As we're not understanding, remember, I cannot show 200 here because the company is indirectly giving me a discount. Right? It's saying it's giving me the laptop for free, which means that in the whole package, they should have charged me 920, but they're charging me 720. They're giving me a discount of $200. Out of which I'm attributing part of the discount to the laptop, part of the discount to the broadband service. Based on our cross multiple calculation, the laptop discounted amount is coming to 158. What about the broadband service? They are charging me $562 for it, but over 2 years. In year one, how much will be satisfied? One out of the 2 years. So one by two, meaning half. So if in year one of the broadband service, revenue that the company will recognize is 1 out of 2 years. 562 into 1 upon 2 years. It could have been how many over years? Okay, we have to recognize 1 year at a time. In this case, it would come to 281. Right? I'm guessing. Yep. And the total revenue is coming to 439. What does this mean? The company's revenue actually for this entire product, for this entire package is $720, but over 2 years. We recognize 439 in year one because in year one, they fulfilled the promise of giving me the laptop and 1 year of the broadband service. The balance of the difference will be recognized in year two. Make sense? So this is how you will solve for F7, whether it's in an MCQ format or it's a part of a bigger question and they're asking you to. So revenue will come approximately for around 5 to 7 marks in F7. ACCA has no pattern, so there is no compulsion that it will come for 5. It can come for 0 marks, it can come for 10 marks. We need to estimate around 5 to 7. In all my experience of doing F7, of giving the exams, of preparing, of teaching others, it generally comes in this range. So we need to prepare enough, and revenue, they can ask the whole chapter in 5 to 7 marks, right? So, and it doesn't matter whether it's MCQs or not. Most people are asking, should I worry about MCQs? Should I worry about big? It doesn't matter. As long as you know this, whether it's an MCQ or not, you'll be able to pass. So just to summarize everything that we've done so far, the 5-step model, again, I'm showing you all, the 5 steps will be here. Please memorize them. And if you don't want to memorize them, try and apply them logically. You cannot start and you cannot have any revenue without having a contract, right? You, like I said, there are different promises that each, in our example, the laptop and the broadband, right? If some transactions have a single promise, very simple for us. Step number 3 is find the price of what the customer is totally paying. Step number four is of the promises, distribute the price, allocate the price to of the different promises. And lastly, the company will recognize the revenue only when the promises are fulfilled. Right? So that's the gist of the five-step model of IFRS 15. So a lot of people have been asking about, I'm going to talk about two things right now, what people have been generally asking me. One is, how is F7 going to be helping them in the future, in their lives after they complete ACCA? And second is, how do you prepare for F7? What are the things to focus on? So when it comes to how is it going to help, right? See, it's one thing to know that, yes, you know, we'll be working in a professional capacity, probably with companies such as the Big Four, or many of us have aspirations to work in these kind of companies. And we will be working in the IFRS, the accounting advisory field, helping companies, you know, create and build their financial statements. So how does that affect you and me? See, think about it like this, okay? India's economy works, a lot of it is based on money being pumped into the economy from foreign institutional investors. They're called FIIs. Huge, huge companies which have a lot of money across the world will come and put their money in India in specific companies that they think really work, especially in the top, the Sensex companies and the Nifty companies. You know, why do they invest in these companies? They believe these companies are going to be doing really well, obviously, but how can they be sure? The answers that these people look at are the financial statements, right? The financial statements which you probably in the future will be helping to create, will be helping. So you help create a revenue statement, you help create an entire financial statement of one company. Let's take somehow in the future, you are going to be creating it for TCS, which is Tata Consultancy Services, one of India's biggest companies, right? You'll help somebody in some other part of the world who's making investment decisions will read TCS's statement which you created and decide whether or not to put in millions, if not billions of dollars into India. Right? Our entire economy goes up and down based on the financial statements. And of course, there are many other factors to it, but one of them is the financial statement. So the more accurate it is, the better of a projection that a company can provide, a more realistic projection, a more realistic image, people from across the world will invest into India. That's one of the things. Another thing is, you know, you help create it for a smaller company. You know, let's take, I'm not sure how many of you all have heard about this company called Practo. Practo is one of India's biggest startups, where it helps doctors book appointments, it helps patients find doctors around. It's into quite a few things. Let's huge investments it's attracting, right? Byju's, which is India's right now biggest education company, edtech company. It can probably become the world's biggest edtech company. How do they attract investors? How do they get people to believe in them, put in money in them, so that it can help more and more people in India? Right, this is all, a huge chunk of it is through the financial statements that you will be creating. Also, I'm sure most of you all know, Ind AS is being mandatorily adopted in India. Ind AS is basically built, a huge chunk of it is built on IFRS, which you and I are learning in F7. So what happens is, you and I can go and help draw the financial statements of almost any company in India, helping other people decide whether the company is doing well or no, and helps basically that company survive, so that if Byju's is helping so millions and millions of Indians learn better, if Byju's stops getting money from, you all know that Mark Zuckerberg's wife's foundation has put $50 million into Byju's, right? The more money comes into Byju's, the better Byju's can serve Indians. This is all based, a huge chunk of it is based on financial statements. That's how F7 will help us. We can be a part of this entire big, the entire game of helping more and more of our economy. The second thing most people ask is, how do we prepare for F7 technically? See, F7, we know that has 60% MCQs, has 40% is subjective. Whether you're right, whether it's a CB exam or paper-based exam, it doesn't matter. Whether to start with MCQs or start with the subjective section, no matter what people tell you, it doesn't matter, right? You are probably more attracted towards MCQs. Maybe you score better with MCQs. Go for it. Right? It doesn't really matter. What matters is, number one, you do not miss out on any question. Right? If you'll remember the rule, if 60 marks worth of MCQs, do not, if you don't know some of them, fluke them. The chances of you getting them correct is 1 out of 4. Right? Do not mess up when it comes to missing any MCQ. And the second more important thing is time management. If you all have heard me talk before, I keep harping about the importance of time management. If you take a full 3-hour, 15-minute section of the paper, per mark is 1.95 minutes. I suggest you take per mark to be of 1.8 minutes. Technically, what that means is you have 3 hours to write the paper, 15 minutes to read the questions. Right? 1.8 minute per question. So, 1.8 minutes per mark. So, 1.8 minutes, 1 mark. 100 marks, 180 minutes. So, 3 hours for 100 marks. Right? So, if you have one question which is for 10 marks, you have 1.8 into 10, 18 minutes to solve that. In the exam, there's always a digital clock. Right? The minute you see 18 minutes complete, you could be, people have the tendency of just saying, oh shit, 18 minutes are up, but let me just complete this answer. And then they go eat time into the next question. Do not make this mistake. It's a trap. Just if 18 minutes are up, treat it like a deadline. No matter how much of the question is complete, skip it. Go to the next question. If at the end you somehow have more time, come back to it. But do not take more than the pre-decided time per question. This is the reason most people end up scoring 48, 49 on 50, on 100, just missing the 50 marks because they missed 5 marks out of the entire paper. Imagine you get 48 and it's because you missed 5 marks. Don't you think you would have passed the paper because you just would have attempted those 5 marks? Huge, huge flaw. Second is please, please keep, when you start the exam question, like I've been always telling, every question, get into the habit of always reading the requirement first. Then read the question. When you open the exam question paper, go to the 40 mark section, read the requirements, go and then up to you, whether you want to start with the MCQs or want to start with the 40 mark subjective point. Please always read the requirements, very important. At home, the key to passing ACCA is writing the entire revision kit. There's a chance you can burn the textbook if you have to, but you cannot skip on even one question of the exam kit. Please write it. Do not read. Whether it's an audit paper or F7 paper, it doesn't matter. Keep writing. Right? You don't have to write every single word, especially the commenting part. Calculation is still easy. What most people do is, that half the marks of ACCA are based on commenting and all of that. Most people solve the first half, get that answer right, because that's a little easy compared to the commenting part. And then they skip the commenting part, they read the commenting part and they think they got it. It's not true, right? What I suggest is, if you see one of my other videos where I've written how I answer these questions, the 40 mark subject, you don't have to write the entire answer, right? You read the question, go back to the answer and just take, write the main keywords, but just keep writing. Okay. So, and the last most important thing is before exams, please, irrespective of where you are, how much time you have, how much of the portion you've completed, attempt at least 2 if not 3 mock papers in exam conditions. If you have an exam tomorrow, you're not prepared, I understand the panic. But the way you, if you really want to give it your best shot tomorrow in those 3 hours 15 minutes, today, irrespective, lock yourself in a room for 3 hours 15 minutes, open a mock from either one of the publishers or go online and get it. 3 hours, 15 minutes, no disturbance, lock yourself in a room, give it as though it was a real exam. Two things will happen. One, you will get into the flow of writing what is going to be coming up tomorrow. And two, you'll honestly get a realistic assumption, realistic picture of where you stand. You might be able to get a 60 on 100 even though you've not completed the portion in the mock, giving you increased much, much more confidence for tomorrow. Right? Mock papers is the ultimate test before you go for an ACCA exam, in terms of time management, in terms of getting into the flow, in terms of gauging where you stand today yourself. So all these points matter when it comes to solving the ACCA exam. So just to summarize your F7 module, doesn't matter whether you start with MCQs or not, make sure you complete the entire paper, stick to the time management side of it. Please give yourself 1.8 minutes per mark, not give yourself any more time. Third, write the entire revision kit at home. And fourth, please, please give at least 2 or 3 mock papers, right? The 40 marks is mostly going to be either 20 mark sum on ratios, Another 20 some will be probably a combination of all the accounting standards. They can ask consolidation, they can ask cash flow. There is no pattern for ACCA to follow, which means we've got to prepare for it all. Right? Just put in all the effort in the last day also, just get enough. Remember, they give ACCA gives you marks for steps also for the 40 marks objective. MCQs is an all or nothing play, so do not skip it at all. Right? Follow this much, attempt, come out of the exam with 100 marks written, chance of you passing would have already increased tremendously.